They are regarded as pioneers in Christian rock music. In more than three decades, they released 20 albums, selling nearly 10 million copies, as well as winning 4 Grammys and 10 Dove Awards. Throughout the 1980s and into the early 1990s, Petra was undoubtedly the world's most popular Christian rock band, selling out arenas and regularly placing songs at the top of Christian radio charts. A resurrected form of the band's 1980s lineup reunited for concerts and re-recordings of its hits from that era. This is classic Petra. In the early 70s, songwriter and guitarist Bob Hartman met bassist John DeGroff at a Bible school in Fort Wayne, Indiana. They were joined by two other classmates, guitarist Greg Hoad and drummer Bill Glover, to form Petra.
We really tried to be a band that played to people like we were before we became Christians. People who might not go into a church or might not enjoy, you know, traditional church music. We wanted people who, you know, listen to rock and roll music and listen to our music and think that there was something there to listen to, and then we could tell them about Jesus and what he'd done for us.
With no lead vocalist, Hartman and Hoag shared singing duties on their self-titled debut album, which was released in 1974. Petra brought in a number of guest vocalists for their second album, Come and Join Us. Among them was a former E vocalist, Greg X. Voltz.
I was in a group called E, which was one of the first Jesus rock groups that started in 70. And in 71, he was with a group called Dove. I remember you came up to me and said, you know, we think the Lord wants you to be our lead singer. And I said, I'll pray about that. Remember, I got that call at 1 o'clock in the morning from the studio. And Dan Brown says, you've got to come help us, man. Interesting thing about that was 6 weeks earlier, I got a call at 1 o'clock in the morning from the same studio. And REO Speedwagon was working on a record, and Kevin Cronin walked out. And the guy that owned the studio, Terry Jameson, knew. And they said, who are we going to get? And he said, what about Voltz? Well, I was an old rival band from REO back when I was with Gideon's Bible, secular group. Before E, and so they called me up, and I'd been a Christian 6 years, and I said I can't do it. And then I get a call from Petra, and the Lord said, now's the time. So bingo, we started banging it out.
Back in the early days, 1970, a backslidden preacher's kid walking down a street in my hometown in Carbondale, Illinois, and it was a flatbed trailer. They were playing music. I went over to listen, and it was Greg Voltz, an E-band. And after talking with Greg for a while, it really cemented that it was time to return home. Well, little did I know that a couple years later, I'd be playing the music from Petra.
The mix of evangelism with rock placed Petra among the early pioneers of Jesus music, part of the larger counterculture Jesus movement of the late 1960s and early 1970s.
The Jesus movement was a genuine Holy Spirit revival. I mean, we like to sometimes look at it as if it were a cultural phenomenon, but no, let's get this straight. It was a Holy Spirit revival.
Yes, sir.
This was people's lives coming out of the gutter, getting saved and turning around completely, and transformation of lives during that time.
E-band, the group that I got, the whole band got saved the same night. I mean, we were a rock and roll, doing shows with Janis Joplin, Chicago, B.B. King, had a record on the charts. Our drummer met a little German lady. She invites to dinner. We come, man says, Jesus is the way, the truth, and life. Holy Ghost, bang, whole group, same night. And the next thing you know, we're out anywhere they let us set up and play. Give them the Great Commission, you know, basically, that why Jesus came and what his purpose was, and people got saved.
The band played small Midwest venues, such as churches, coffee houses, and parks, to share the message of Christianity with concert goers.
You know, we began, both of us in our, you know, you and E-band and me and my bands before Petra, mm-hmm. and then Petra, yeah. Were really aimed at evangelism.
Absolutely.
That's what we were, you know,
100%.
We were used
100%
in evangelism.
Go out to the highways and byways and compel them to come in.
Yeah, like you said, we played in commons.
We played anywhere they let us set up.
Church authorities struggled with and frequently opposed the use of churches for rock concerts, and only a few Christian radio stations would play the band's songs. Petra was criticized for its rock sound, a hint of the opposition it would experience as its popularity grew.
The atmosphere was, needless to say, folks were a little confused and uncertain about the music they were listening to, because all they'd been used to was choirs and quartets and didn't have an electric guitar or bass. I still remember getting phone calls from well-intended church folk who told me I was going to hell. I was playing the devil's music.
But then we began to see how more and more Christians began to benefit from having their music, you know, music that was about the Lord that they could listen to, that was the type of music that they liked.
As the years progressed, more and more of the music started to come out, and we get listeners all over the country, especially listening to rock stations, because the Christian stations weren't going to handle it yet. The thing I really appreciate about Petra was that I saw an authenticity in their lifestyle. They wanted to be committed to a local church, to a pastor. They didn't operate, even though they were young and immature, I didn't sense that they operated on a knee-jerk reaction to the rejection that they had. They still took every effort to encourage people to understand what they were doing.
Among Volz's songs on the Come and Join Us album was a cover of the Argent anthem, God Gave Rock and Roll to You, which Myrrh Records had hoped to release as a radio single to the secular market. The song was immediately controversial and revolutionary.
God gave rock and roll to you. Now, first of all, for us to record that song was Dan Brock's idea, our manager. He knew that song from the band Argent, secular band, recorded this song. It was pretty obscure at the time. I had never heard the song.
No.
They weren't playing it on the radio.
Never.
But this oddball song by this band Argent, God Gave Rock and Roll to You. Okay, so we listened to it, and I thought, you know, those lyrics don't really say, well, anything that we want to say as a Christian band. So we contacted the publisher. We told them we wanted to do the song. We wanted to change, you know, some lyrics, and they said, okay. We did that song, released that song, and a lot of Christians just really loved it. But it also became one of the most controversial songs, and people were saying, well, what do you mean by that? You know, God gave rock and roll to you. Because that's kind of a pretty bold statement right in the face of people who are saying rock and roll is
of the devil. Right, yeah.
Know? And it was. It was definitely a counter statement to that. Then this whole thing later happened with Kiss recording that song. Now, what they did, though, is they did the same thing we did.
It was years
they
later.
Went to
years
the publisher
later.
And got permission to record,
exactly.
Years later, yes. Got permission to record Argent's song, God Gave Rock and Roll to You, and they did the original lyrics. They didn't change the lyrics like we did.
Right.
So we get questions from people saying, why'd you let Kiss do your song?
They thought it was ours.
And why'd you let them change the lyrics?
Yeah.
They changed the lyrics of your song. No. You know, we have to explain it. So, you know, it's, and we do that all the time.
Over the next few years, Petra experienced the first of numerous lineup changes within the band. Hoag left to form his own band, and DeGroff followed suit. By the early 80s, Wash's Whiter Than, the band's third album, was not a big seller, largely due to distribution problems. With no record sales, no way to promote the album nationally, and barely any band, Hartman considered breaking up Petra. Instead, Hartman met Mark Kelly, a former lead vocalist and bassist for the Bible College group One Accord, and keyboardist John Slick at a Bible study, and hired them to join him and Volz.
It's funny how I actually met Bob. I lived with a buddy in an apartment complex on the south side of Nashville, and he's a studio engineer, still is a studio engineer here in Nashville. And one day he says, hey, you remember the group Petra? Yeah, sure. And he says, well, Bob Hartman with Petra lives right here in the same complex we do. As a matter of fact, he has a Bible study that he teaches once a week. I said, let's go. So we went. As I got to know Bob, and enjoy and appreciate the depth of his knowledge and his understanding of the Word and his ability as a teacher. And perhaps that's something that a lot of people are unaware of. Here was Bob Hartman teaching a Bible study, and that's the foundation and the level of trust and depth of our relationship that showed me, you know, this is somebody I want to be connected with in ministry. This is someone I can trust. This is someone I know really has a heart for the ministry.
Oh, I can remember very clearly a time when the record labels, Christian record labels, believed that there was no way a Christian rock band would ever be successful.
Right.
They would say that. We're going to put your record out, but don't expect much, you know, kind of attitude.
Petra released its fourth album, Never Say Die, with the first single, a song originally written and performed by Volta's old band. The Coloring Song was Petra's big break, rocketing to the top of Christian radio charts.
Red is the color of the blood that flowed down the face of someone who loved us so.
It became the 14th highest-ranked single of the decade on the Christian Adult Contemporary charts. Never Say Die became the breakthrough album for which the band and its label, Star Song Records, had hoped, receiving rave reviews.
The thing about Petra's 10-year overnight success, everybody worked jobs. We all worked jobs to go out and play on weekends, to share our testimonies and preach the gospel. Not for money. We never made money back then. But when the Coloring Song, which was actually came from E., David Eden wrote it in 1971, went in. Benson pushed it as a single, number one on every chart for 6 weeks, even Southern Gospel. And Petra became a 10-year overnight success.
You know, the album before, Watch This Whiter Than, which Greg performed on, was actually an album that sort of, you know, we were nervous about.
They were trying to change the image of the band.
They were. We did more ballads.
Pop.
And it was lighter.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that was during the time when those people were saying, well, a Christian rock band is never going to be successful. No, not Christian music. So on Never Say Die, we kind of said, okay,
we don't care.
We're not doing this.
We're doing what we want to do.
Yeah, we're doing what we feel in our hearts.
Yep.
The songs were
blatantly gospel.
And blatantly in your face.
And blatantly
they
rock and roll.
In your face, chameleon.
That'll test you.
Chameleon,
that'll,
you know, saying, you know, you blend with your surroundings, you know, I mean,
yeah.
come out of the world, you know. I mean, they were what we wanted to say, strong things, and the music was strong.
Shortly after recording Never Say Die, Petra hired Louis Weaver, a former drummer with early Christian rock acts, Randy Matthews and Fireworks. Louis became a Petra fan while studying music at Tribeca Nazarene University.
I mean, I was instantly a Petra fan. They came to Tribeca to do a concert. You know, we actually were sitting outside waiting for them to pull up in their motorhome, pull in the trailer, and I got to know the guys. And from that night of that concert, I sat and asked, actually prayed to God. I said, God, I want to be in Petra. And from that point in my life, I was seeking God's vision, purpose for me. I went through a couple of more bands after that, but knew, even by the guy that was the lead singer of that group, came to me one day and I said, Louis, I know God wants you to be the drummer for Petra, but you just have to wait on him. And that's been my whole testimony for 30 years now, is God honed me, pruned me to be the drummer for Petra, and that's, I'm sorry, that's all I've ever really sank my teeth into my whole life, was doing what God called me to do in this band.
The band's touring lineup was set, and Petra went on the road for 300 days in 1982, playing 162 shows and stopping for only the 5 weeks it took to record the follow-up album, More Power to Ya.
You say you've been feeling weaker, weaker by the day.
The title track became a smash radio hit, and the album became one of the five best-selling albums in Christian music a year after its release. The band also began receiving attention from the mainstream music industry, as Billboard magazine dubbed More Power to You a top album pick, and praised the band's surging music, tough lyrics, and effective vocals. More power
to you. I tell you, when I listen to More Power to You, it still does the same thing to me that it did 25 years ago. And when I've been ministering in local churches for about the last 15 years, and people would just start crying because they remembered the first time that they heard it and what it did to them. And I can't explain why that is, other than that it's just something, it's something miraculous that God does, and he just puts his stamp on it and says, you know, the Lord is ageless, timeless, and things that are born of the Spirit, I think, are timeless. And when songs like that, that really come out of the depths of the Spirit, they're going to be that way. It'll be that way 50 years from now.
Petra also used the record to diffuse the backward masking controversy, which had begun to spread into Christian music. Conservative church leaders accused Christian artists of hiding subliminal messages that could only be heard when the records were played in reverse.
Backwards masking was a big thing at this time. People were playing, people were going out and buying secular records to play backwards, to try to hear the message. And Christians were going out and doing this, buying these secular records to try to be the first one to discover the newest back masking, you know, the newest devil message on so-and-so's record. And so, you know, it was getting insane. And there were guys making the circuit. There were guys
on television. They spent the whole shows.
Yeah, they were going around from church to church and making a living.
It was
talking about backwards masking.
Not Jesus.
That was their whole ministry. Their whole ministry was to have, you know, to come, people come, and they hear them talk about backwards masking, and they play it. Now, here. Now, listen to this. Doesn't that say...
Well, the hi-hat going, you know, open and closing the hi-hat,
yeah,
goes, Satan, Satan, Satan,
yeah,
if you play it backwards. See? It said, listen, you know, now listen, and
was,
you have to listen close.
I mean,
and they would
it
convince
just
people.
Getting, it was just getting
it was ridiculous.
It was funny. It was comical at times to get to hear the reactions from some of the other guys that they'd say, you cannot believe what this person said or what they were thinking or the level of concern they had for us.
So I said, listen, why don't we put a message on here? A backwards message that says, what are you looking for the devil for when you ought to be looking for the Lord? Because that was what they were doing. They were looking for the devil.
And it wasn't masked either. It was just backwards.
Right. It was just a backwards message. And so, you know, the beginning of the song, you know, you hear this.
To coin the phrase, you can quote us on that one.
What are you looking for the devil for when you ought to be looking for the Lord?
It was not the first, nor would it be the last time, Petra weighed in against critics of contemporary Christian music.
You know, at the time when Petra began, there was open preaching in the pulpit against rock music, and people believing that rock music was, quote-unquote, of the devil.
These were household names of people that I thought the world of. As a young preacher's kid growing up in my denomination, I thought this pastor, this preacher, this evangelist was the greatest thing in the world, only to grow up and be a part of a ministry where that individual that I idolized was now preaching and praying against the success of the ministry that I'm involved in. So you ask me if it hurt, how I felt about it, it hurt. It hurt a lot.
And I remember feeling like, what? Praying against us, but we're here to serve this community, you know, to win people that they're not able to reach with what we do, to be a help to them, to build their body here.
Later years, we were playing in San Francisco, and we had picketers out, and we were driving up, and I said, stop the van, I'm out of here. I got out, and I went up, and I talked to the guy. I said, why are you doing this? Do you know who I am? He goes, yeah. I said, do you know me personally? He said, no. I said, I'm doing this for God. How can you hold this sign up? You don't know me personally. Dude, this is wrong.
the motivation and the strength from the Holy Spirit, it was common in each one of us that we knew what we were doing was right. And we knew that one day things would change, and the people that didn't understand it then would eventually see the fruit.
Lord, we just worship you and thank you for being in our lives, for taking care of us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we just give this night to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
When we are opposed and bands are opposed, there's a reaction to it. It comes out in their music or in something they say in the press. And I didn't see that with Petra. I know that it brought them closer together as a family, as it did our whole Jesus music community.
Well, there was no circuits. There were no, support networks. You know, you were out there with your passion. And that's the thing that I think God's looking for today.
Right. Everybody that had us, every sponsor, you know, was taking a risk in their community.
True.
Because there were churches that would talk bad about them because they were sponsoring this thing.
Yeah.
You know, you're bringing in this evil rock band.
Evil.
You know?
Oh, how many got saved? 100? Really?
At the end of every one of our concerts, we had an invitation. We had an invitation for people to accept Christ every night.
You feel a small voice, a knowing inside that God is calling you, because today is the day of salvation for you.
And there are people tonight that are hearing the voice of God, some for the first time. All of a sudden your being's being touched. Something stirring inside of you, an excitement. Woo! Yeah! I know what you mean. Something fresh and alive is happening. Now, if you want the Lord tonight and you want to serve God, if you want to be a part of the family of God, if you feel faith in your heart to believe that Jesus is the Son of God and He's given His life for you, shed His blood for you, then I want you to tell Him. I want you to say a prayer with me.
And it was a very well-orchestrated, organized effort where we would go into a community, and we had people that would do preparation in every community before we ever came to town. There would be youth directors, youth pastors, staff people from local churches and youth groups that were ready, they were prepared, they were well-organized to accept those people who were coming down to the front to accept Christ.
If you've ever led anyone to the Lord, there's something that happens to you. There's a feeling that you get that's just indescribable. And when you see people come to the Lord in those concerts, there's an energy and a strength that God gives to you. I mean, I just loved what I did. I loved doing it. And I think I could say that for all the rest of the members of the band. We loved what we did.
In 1983, Petra played 152 shows, taking 6 weeks off that summer to record their next album, Not of This World. It was well received critically and commercially. In addition, Not of This World garnered Petra its first Grammy nomination for Best Performance by a Duo, Group, Choir, or Chorus in 1985. To support the album, Petra launched its biggest tour yet with 150 dates around the world. Headlining for the first time, Petra poured resources into creating a concert experience as dynamic as any secular rock band, using numerous lights, stage effects, and costumes.
Out of This World, to me, it's like we were hitting our stride there. We were finding what God was using, and we were understanding our own ministry more.
Thousands of people have been coming to the Lord.
I do remember the Not of This World tour as being a really high point.
It was.
Things were exploding.
They were exploding.
Every time we turned around, the concert sold out.
All
we
of
had
them.
They want to move it to a bigger venue. They want to add another show.
Yep.
It was like we could not keep up.
We did everything we could to bring the highest level of quality and professionalism to our performance and to what we did on stage every night.
No Christian rock band had sold more records, played before bigger crowds, or had enjoyed such massive airplay. As Petra was preparing to enter the studio and record their follow-up album, John Slick left the band. John Lowry, who had played with the band during the Not of This World tour, joined officially as Petra's newest keyboardist.
I was in the Joe English band, and we were doing a different style, but when I heard the Petra stuff, I said, hey, that's pretty cool, because I grew up, like a lot of us rockers, listening to these artists, but Deep Purple and, who else, Jeff Beck and Kansas and Yes. And I felt like this band was more in those lines. When I heard the Petra stuff, I really liked the writing, but I really, really liked the lyrics. There was just a wonderful anointing and strength in the lyrics that kind of pulled me into it.
Beat the System was released in 1985, and it featured a dramatic departure from Petra's previous style, emphasizing keyboards, electronic drums, and computerized sound effects. The techno-industrial record was a monster hit.
At the time, the Fairlight synthesizer was a new thing. Basically, what this was, for people that don't remember, it was a keyboard hooked to a computer that had a built-in sequencer. It was a sampler, and there were sampled sounds.
You could sample your voice or anything.
And at the time, that was new.
We had used so much Fairlight on the album, I bought a Fairlight because we needed it for the orchestration, for some of the percussion effects, and also sonically. So, of course, I got one, and then we had to set up the house, and I'm taking the barbecue grill and sampling that, because it was the first keyboard that actually could take a sound bite of anything in an environment and make a musical instrument out of it. So, in the course of the tour, I was going, I really miss my family. You know, my son was 4 years old, and you know, having a wife at home and a son. So I set up a microphone in our living room, and I had them say things like, I love you, my little boy, I love you, Daddy, and my wife, of course, I love you, and God bless you, you know, Jesus loves you, Jesus loves you. And then at sound check on the road, I would hit those so I could hear my family. And one day I was going, Jesus loves you, Gigi, Gigi, and something just happened. And I started doing the solo thing, and the road crew went, I said, okay, I'm going to try it tonight.
He was sampling the expression Jesus loves you, and he'd play that on the keyboard, reproduced, and the crowd loved it. The crowd absolutely loved it.
Think about it. One of the first things the sampling technology did was proclaim the love of Jesus. And so it was kind of an unusual situation, and I never thought about it until I reflected back and said, you know, that was one of the first concert sample musical performance voice samples in the history of music.
One of the songs on the album, Hollow Eyes, was a particular favorite for one of the band members.
Hollow Eyes for me, which talks about abandonment and taking care of orphans, that song has been very special. A lot of people probably know this already that are Petra fans, but I was found on the streets of Japan starving at 4 years old of malnutrition. And I was abandoned just trying to survive. I don't remember it, but I've been told of the history. I ended up being taken care of by missionaries. And I was living in an orphanage in Sasebo, Japan, and I was Amerasian. Back then, there was a lot of prejudice against mixed-race biracial babies, which I am Japanese and American. We don't really know the history of my American side. But the missionaries took me in, really, it was a blessing of God. And in the course of that, some sailors would come for Christmas and bring Christmas presents. And two young gentlemen saw that I was Amerasian. They contacted some people in Michigan and said, if you adopt this boy, we will pay for it. And those two young men had me flown over and adopted into a family. What a wonderful gift. And because of that, I've been able to grow up in this country, which I think is awesome. And I'm really grateful for that.
In the end, Beat the System was one of the nation's top two Christian albums for nearly half a year, and Billboard had certified Petra as the biggest-selling gospel music group in the country. For the second consecutive year, the band was nominated for a Grammy for Best Gospel Performance by a duo, group, choir, or chorus. Ultimately, Petra played to more than 500,000 people during the Beat the System World Tour, and they recorded performances over a three-night period to release their live album, Captured in Time and Space.
Beat the System was the first tour where it was like announced that we were going out on this new record. And I walked out on that stage. I'd never been involved with anything at that level. So me, it was like I was amazed by the production.
I remember the first time I saw that set. They said they were building it. I had seen a drawing of it. I walked into TPAC. We had like a week of rehearsal there. That was the most awesome, biggest thing I'd ever seen in my life, walking in and setting my drums up on that platform.
As constant touring took its toll on the band, Hartman and Volz began to disagree about Petra's future. The tour, while it drew more fans than ever, was expensive, and it left Petra hurting financially. In 1985, Volz announced that he would leave the band to pursue a solo career, leaving in doubt the future of the world's biggest Christian rock band.
Well, a strange thing happens when you're on the road 300 days a year, 275, in a row. Your family begins to fall apart. And there were just problems that began to come up. And the only way that I could see in order to try to salvage that was to just say, guys, you know, I got to go. And it was not really something I wanted to do, but I just needed to do that. And that would be probably the first and foremost, the biggest reason.
I was friends with Greg and Bob. And I'm seeing it separate. I've been there a year. And I actually got immediate phone calls from some other bands that are very successful at the time, and I was really torn.
There's at least a dozen times during the course of Petra's thing where I thought, this is it, it's over, we're done. Yep.
It took a level of faith to know that God was still in control. You know? That God was still in control of this ministry, that he was going to provide.
I'm feeling like, let's see what happens. If we go forward here, let's see if we can go forward. Let's see, you know, what God wants to do.
So Mark Kelly, Bob, and I collected it back together. Then we got Louie in, and we started taking off again.
And I'd introduced my replacement, John, back 82, 83 at the Lincoln Theater. I'd known him from back in the group that he was with before. And I remember I first introduced John to the band, but didn't think about it. You know, 4 years later, that this guy was going to be the one that would come in to do it.
And John Schlitz's name came up, and so we actually went up there and visited with him, and it just, he was our first person we auditioned, first and last. It was just like it fit great.
God would honor the fact that the four guys that still remained in Petra and prayed together and fasted together and believed that God would provide. Guess what? He did.
I knew the band would continue on, that it wasn't just about one personality. Bob Hartman never wanted it to be about one personality except a man named Jesus Christ. And so many adjustments were made. They made an incredible choice in bringing John Slid on, and you can see they continued quite well for quite a while.
Throughout the next 10 years, Petra went on to have various degrees of success, along with changes in record labels, music styles, and band members. In 2005, after 33 years in the Christian music industry, the band announced their retirement with a farewell tour. Over the next few years, incarnations of Petra would get together to perform reunion shows. In early 2010, former Petra members agreed to reunite to record an album, Back to the Rock, with a subsequent world tour. The classic lineup features Bob Hartman on guitars, Greg X. Volz on vocals, Mark Kelly on bass, Louis Weaver on drums, and John Lowry on keyboards.
I got a call from a promoter, and he asked me to put a band together and go out with White Hart for 20 dates in the fall. They were going to get back together and do a little reunion thing. And I have a band called Victor in Atlanta that would be glad to go out. Already learned a lot of my stuff. But for some strange reason, and I can't explain why, when he said that, I said, well, yeah, I can do that, but why not just have Petra go with him? He said, can you do that? I said, I don't know. I'll call my old partner and I'll ask him. So I called Bob up and I said, Bob, I got this promoter, da-da-da-da-da-da. And he said, well, you know, I need to talk to John, but yeah, I think we can do that. What about the other guys? So I called John Lowry. John said, yeah, I would do that for 20 dates. And I called Louis. Louis said, yeah, I could do that for 20 dates. And so everybody said, yeah. Well, then out of nowhere, 2 weeks later, I get Facebook from our old tour manager, Mike Nautical, and he had just, I hadn't talked to him in 25 years. And he just moved from California to back to Nashville, surprise, and he left his phone number and I called him up and he said, well, what are you doing? I said, well, you know, Mike, this is strange, but it looks like the old band's getting back together. And he said, I'm in. Just like that. And then with his contacts and stuff, things began to take shape, and one miracle, I mean literally, one miracle after another began to take place that you couldn't, there's no way except the Lord.
To have this whole full circle thing now, coming back 25 years after this, you know, group of guys last performed together and doing it again, this is just, this stuff doesn't happen much.
It's kind of like a shock, you know, to go full circle because, you know, it's been since 94 that I've actually been back in a band, and the reason was to get off the road and produce records and raise my family. I've had a long-term great relationship with Greg and Bob and the guys, so I've been in touch and we've been friends, but we've all been doing different things.
And when we got together and started rehearsing at John's studio, it was like there was this feeling, there was a feeling that it was just, it was like, it was joy, I mean, if I can say that. That's what makes this so special about this reunion, because I have to say, I never finished my commission with Petra. I never did. And I'm really grateful to God to get a chance to get back with these guys that I have great respect for, and I love them very much.
I'm just grateful that you can honestly see the healing that's taken place and that Greg is fully restored with the band. They are so excited that he is a different person. And that, again, speaks of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that there's restoration and hope.
And it's overwhelming, and it's the most exciting thing I've had happen to me in 10 years, at least. And to be back on stage with Greg singing, I thought I lost his friendship. I thought for years we didn't. It's just, it's so most exciting thing that's happened to me since I got in Petra.
I can tell you where we are right now, that each one of us in Classic Petra would be able to give you a story about how this is a second chance. And God is the God of a second chance.
First conversation I had with Bob was, there came a point in my life when I realized it was a gnawing, aching awareness, a painful feeling in my spirit that I knew that I had given away my birthright when I left the band. And you may have to cut some of this out. I felt like I'd turned my back on God. But I know, once again, this is where I'm supposed to be. It's a miracle. It's a second chance.
Kicking off their reunion tour, the band performed a concert in November 2010 at the Trinity Music City Auditorium in Nashville, Tennessee. Excited fans from all over the area gathered to see and hear Classic Petra.
Back to rock,
You know, the fan base for Petra has always been extremely loyal. The excitement of the band coming back together again with the original members says it right there.
Favorite songs, favorite records?
Mine's More Power to You. Excellent album. It's the greatest album of that lineup, I think, they have.
So, favorite Petra record?
Favorite from classic Petra would be None of This World. Awesome track is Grave Robber and Judas Kiss, another album.
Now, you brought your LP just to show the band that you're like a diehard old-school fan.
Yeah, diehard fan.
Show me your LP and tell me about it.
It's the Never Say Die album. And basically this album, everybody that's here in classic Petra went on tour for the Never Say Die tour. The only one who's not on the album is Louie Weaver, but he was the one who was a drummer for the tour.
What's your favorite Petra song?
This Means War.
The coloring song, what was the one we were just talking about?
Grave Robber.
Grave Robber is another one of my favorites from the earlier days.
Well, I just have another that's on the set tonight.
Good. Cool. Looking forward to that.
Deepest System was the first Christian CD I owned, so of course it had a lot to do with my early Christianity, coming to the Lord and hearing their music as an early Christian.
First saw them in 85, so the same group of guys, and it was my first rock concert, so looking forward to it. Favorite songs would be Not of This World and Beat the System.
Excited that the guys are back to you?
Absolutely. I just want to tell them thank you for ministering to us. Just our rebellious generation in the mid-80s, you know, punk rockers. And I was just out partying one night, and a friend just slips this Captured in Time and Space CD to me. And that whole album just ministered to me. The Holy Spirit was all over it. And when it got to the end, it is finished. That song just did me in. You know, it's like there's no way I could say no to the love of Jesus. And it was a live set, so on the album there was an altar call, and I responded to the altar call right there in my car after a night of partying, and that was it. So God bless you guys. Thank you.
I'm Joyce from Ann Arbor, Michigan, and I love Petra. And I've watched them for a long, long time. 1 year, six different concerts in 1 year. And my favorite is Beat the System. I love them all. I can't wait.
I've worked with a lot of different groups over the past 20, 25 years. And I have to say that it was very difficult for me to get used to band members and management that literally just walked in the door and said, whatever you want to do. I've never heard that before, and I've worked with some great people that are very nice and very flexible, but I've never had somebody come in and just say whatever you want to do. And there was not this prima donna puffed up, you know, we're legends, and they just have been great.
They're out doing tours and playing the music, and we have not even begun to see what God can do with a band who's willing to go back and not try to build on the past, but to do things even fresh and new. And I believe we're going to see lots of new music, lots of new things happening with Petra, because they're serious about bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ to people's lives. They're serious about knowing that what they're doing is making an impact on their generation and now on the next generation.
We have no illusions of being rock stars or anything. We're here because of a purpose.
And you know, we have no claim of being geniuses. I mean,
we just show up.
One day with us and you know that that's not, you know, okay, that cannot be, okay? In fact, one day with us and you're going, these people make records?
It was just a blast to get together. It was just like talking about old times and the memories of those great moments. And it's been a wonderful time.
Bob, Greg, Mark, me and Johnny had a camaraderie together that wasn't there before or after. That's just the way I look at it.
We're very humbled and we're very privileged to be a part of something that we think God is trying to do again. And It's exciting.
Video 5, 6, 4. I don't think that anybody knows how deeply the effect of the best known Christian rock band in the world has had on even today's music, and people that listen to that music have inspired to go ahead and to, you know, write songs and get out there and perform. We owe a lot to what God has done through the rock, through Petra.
Graham, let me know when they're coming out. Yeah, darken the house monitors.
We thank you for your presence. We thank you for our spirit of calmness. God, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit that breaks yokes. God, I ask you to bless the socks off of this audience. Be with us, guide us, and speak to us in the name of Jesus. We commit this night to you, Father. We love you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.